The main purpose of the Buddhist meditation is understanding oneself, because the ultimate realization of the Four Noble Truths preached by the Buddha for 45 years are to be found not in the Buddhist canon, nor in the Buddhist commentaries, but within oneself. Buddha spoke of dukkha, samudaya, magga and nirodha. Dukkha is translated as suffering. Suffering is within oneself. Samudaya is referred to by the Buddha as the cause of suffering. The cause of suffering is within oneself, not in the books, not in the preachings. Then the final cessation of suffering, called Nirodha Satya, referred to as Nirvana, too is within oneself. And the particular technique with which one can attain Nirvana is within oneself. Therefore, understanding oneself is the one and only way to realize the sublime truth spoken by the Buddha. That understanding is possible only by constant observation of oneself. Here we see ourselves as our own mind. Our mind is the product of our body. Our body is the seat of our mind. The main function, the two main functions of our mind is sensation and thinking. We think with the help of our knowledge. Knowledge is the memories that we have retained in our brain throughout our life, through our experiences in life. Whatever knowledge we have about ourselves or our surrounding or the world in which we live or the life or the universe is very limited. Whatever knowledge, even what a specialist, a great specialist has, is limited. Therefore, we cannot realize the boundless truth spoken by the Buddha, unlimited truth spoken by the Buddha, with a limited mind, with its limited knowledge. The truth spoken by the Buddha is beyond the mind. Buddha himself, after enlightenment, is reported to have uttered, his thinking process stopped at the enlightenment. Therefore, the final truth is beyond the thinking process, based on our memories that we call our knowledge. This we can understand only by observing ourselves. Ourselves, as I referred to earlier, is nothing but our own mind. Therefore, the Buddhist meditation means vigilant, constant, intelligent awareness of one's own mental activities. It is only through constant observation that we ultimately realize what we call ourselves or myself is only an image formed by our own mind. Our mind is a reservoir, a container of such images. We call our mother or father, wife or husband, daughter or son, referring to our own mental image. That such mental images we can call as realities, though they are real, they are not actually true. They are not, those images are not the things or the items that they represent. They are only illusory reflections. Even with regard to ourselves, we have built up an image of ourselves based on the memories of our past experience. I was a such and such a child at such and such a time. I studied in such and such a school or college or university. I had such and such parents, brothers and sisters. I lived in such a village or town or country. Those are all memories. They are not the realities they represent. But we see these images as realities. Then, in observing ourselves, we start realizing gradually there is no permanent identity that can be retained as ourself, as our soul, as believed in many religions. The main experience that we get by observing our own mind, our own thinking process, our own image making, our own ideas, we realize gradually that everything within the mind is born to decay and die. Thoughts are like waves. They are always in motion. They are born to decay and die. When one thought vanishes, another thought appears. And that too cannot last long, it too vanishes. Therefore, there is a thought process in our mind. And what we call ourself or myself is a product of our thoughts. While all our thoughts are the product of our own mind, our own thoughts. Thoughts produce the self. The self produces thoughts. What we call self is a bundle of past memories. Memories are not actual realities, but only illusory realities that appear to be true when we experience them. When we see the picture of our mother or father or wife or husband. All our inner sense organs become active. For example, when our eye can see, observe the picture or the image of our mother, our inner ear can hear her voice. Our inner nose can smell her fragrance. Our inner nose experiences a fragrance. Our inner tongue can experience the taste of the food she prepared. Our skin, the inner skin, can sense her touch, how she was caressing us, how we were touching her. The sensation of the touch of the mother can be felt at the same at that time. And when you see, it is the mental image retained in our mind that crops up as our mother. All those images, all those sensations are real but not actual. They are not realities, they are only illusions. When we examine ourselves, observing our own thought process constantly, we realize that there is no permanent identity that can be retained as ourself or soul. There are only memories. Memories are not actual realities. They appear to be real, but actually they are not real. They are only mind-made imaginations, imaginary phenomena that we experience as our thought. In this process of observation, one can gradually realize that what we call ourselves is only a mirage, only an illusion. It is the real realization of the truth that leads one to enlightenment. When the Buddha was about to pass away, unenlightened disciples of the Buddha asked the Buddha, With whose help can we be enlightened after your passing away? Buddha emphatically said, to be a light unto oneself, he didn't say, depend on my preachings, depend on the discipline I have preached, depend on the doctrine I have preached. He never asked to depend on his own preaching. He said, the Four Noble Truths I spoke is nowhere, not in the preaching as recorded or as remembered in the memory cells, retained in the memory cells. The Four Noble Truths is within oneself. Therefore, Buddha said, be a light unto oneself. That means, look at your own self with the light of your own wisdom or intelligence. Then you can see the suffering, the cause of suffering, the cessation of suffering, and the way for the cessation of suffering within yourself. Therefore, observation of oneself is the one and only technique of getting enlightenment, getting enlightened. In observing our own thought process, our own imaginations, our own thinking, one realizes their futility. Every thought is born to decay and die. The entire world that we experience is made of thoughts. No one can experience the real world outside oneself. We cannot see the colors as they really are in the outside world. We cannot hear the sounds as they are really outside our world. Not even smells, not even taste. We can experience only the colors, the pictures, the images created by our eye. We can hear only the sounds created by our ear. We can smell only the smells created by our nose. We can taste only the taste created by our tongue. We can experience the touch, that is sensation, only created by the skin. If the skin or the organ is paralyzed, we can't experience anything. That shows our entire world is within our own physical body. That's why Buddha has uttered in the Rohitatva Sutta, Vyamamate Kaleberi Panyapemi Lokancha. That means the entire world that we experience is within our one fathom body, the body of about 6 feet. Not only the world, Lokancha, Loka Samudayancha, Loka Nirodhancha, Loka Nirodha Gami Patapadanta. The world is within our body. The cause of the creation of that world is within our body. The ultimate cessation of that world is within our body. The way for the cessation of that world too is in our body. That means the Four Noble Truths is within ourselves. Because Four Noble Truths is about the world, the truth of the world that we experience. What is the basic truth of the world? Dukkha. Dukkha, though it is translated as suffering, it is suffering is also a form of dukkha. The original word means transformation. Transformation of what? The transformation of the dynamic energy. The energy with which everything in this world, in this universe is created, is dynamic, active, creative, identified as a creator God. When there is constant activity, that is anicchata in Buddha's word, dynamism, universal dynamism. Due to universal dynamism, there is a constant transformation throughout the universe. In every item in it, every item is getting changed, that is called dukkha. Anicca dukkha. Therefore, Buddha said, nothing can retain a permanent identity. Anatta. Anatta means, it is translated as no soul, but that is not a correct translation. It doesn't deny the soul the atta. Atta is a reality. I am here is a reality. I am speaking is a reality. You hear what I speak is a reality. They are realities, though they are not ultimate truths, actualities. Anattata means soullessness in Buddhism, means only one aspect of a universal truth, the universal nature. Buddha referred to triple nature of the universe called Tilakkana, Trilakshana. He referred to it as Anicca, Dukkha, Anatta. Anatta is only one aspect. That aspect should not be taken as a separate saying that there is no soul. That is not true. A soul or self is a practical, actual reality, though it is not a final truth or ultimate truth. That is what we can experience. We can experience in our own mind. The mind is dynamic, creative, dynamic, moving. Samsarana, moving, is always in motion. The mind can move into our past, it can move into our future, it can move into distant lands, distant areas, it can move to sun or moon or distant planets. That is mental traveling, mental motion. The mind is always in motion. That is anicca, dynamism. Because of that constant motion, there is a constant transformation. That is dukkata. Because of constant transformation, nothing can retain a permanent identity. And the basic truth that we can realize by observing ourselves is, every idea, every image, every thought, every feeling is born to decay and die then and there. When that truth is realized, one's mind becomes very calm and quiet, free from disturbances. Such a mind cannot be disturbed by the worldly vicissitudes. That is why it is said in Mahamangala Sutra, Puttasya Loka Dhammehi Chittang Yasana Kampati. When one is enlightened, no incident in the world outside or inside cannot disturb the peace of mind within the enlightened mind. Puttasya Loka Dhammehi Chittang Yasana Kampati. When we realize that truth through constant observation of ourselves, we also become very peaceful in our mind. Peace is also a basis for real realization of the truth within us. Therefore, the Buddhist meditation has two aspects. One is tranquility meditation, making the mind tranquil. Mind becomes tranquil sometimes through concentration, through attention, focusing the mind only on one object. That is only a technique to make mind peaceful, calm and quiet. It is only a calm and quiet that can observe one's own mental process better, unprejudiced by different prejudices. Then there is another aspect of the Buddhist meditation, insight meditation, called Vidasana Bhavana. Samatha Bhavana is tranquility meditation. Vidasana Bhavana is insight meditation. A calm mind can observe, go deep into oneself. Inner sight is the eye that can realize the ultimate truth within ourselves as well as without or outside ourselves. We are not separated from the universe outside us. We are the product of the universe. Universal forces are working around us and within us. We are part and parcel of the universe, the energy field, the universal energy. We are made of the universal energy. It is this universal energy. Energy is not a thing but an activity, which is dynamic. It is this universal energy referred to by the Buddha as universal anicchata, impermanency, dynamism. It is the transformation of this energy Buddha referred to as the dukkata, titasya anyatatta bhavisati, evolution, transformation, one state getting changed into another state constantly. That is why Buddha said nothing can retain a permanent identity. When this reality is realized by ourselves, by our own observation, not through the ideas of others, not through the description of the others, but through self-realization, one doesn't get attached to things that are present, they know, because one knows that whatever pleasant is subject to birth, decay and death, jati, jara, marana. Similarly, one does not get disturbed by things unpleasant. They too are born to decay and die. Such a mind becomes neutral between the pleasant and the unpleasant. Such a mind can take both the pleasant and the unpleasant as they are. And such a mind is a tranquil mind. It is with a tranquil mind that one can attain the final freedom called vimukti. Buddha said that in Paharada Sutta, as there is salt taste throughout the ocean, there is the taste of freedom in his teaching. Therefore, freedom is the basis of Buddha's teaching. And that freedom we have to achieve ourselves from our own self. We have to free ourselves from ourselves. What is ourself? The memories, the images of past experience that we have retained in our brain cells. They dictate us. They dictate us through our mind. Mind is our Lord, Manendriya. Indriya means the Lord, the ruler. We are ruled by our five sense organs. They are our dictators. They are our lords. They are our rulers. We are guided by them. We are directed by them. We are moved by them. It is the freedom from the dictatorship of our sense organs that is called real freedom in Buddhism, as well as the freedom from our own traditions, freedom from our own memories, freedom from our own knowledge. Whatever knowledge that we have is limited. If you say If we say we know something, what we do not know about it is more than what we know about it. Therefore, our knowledge means our own ignorance. Therefore, being dictated by knowledge means being dictated by our ignorance. The reality is therefore is beyond knowledge, and the capacity to realize the reality is called wisdom. Knowledge is acquired by our sense organs from the world outside us. Wisdom is not an acquired capacity, it is an inborn capacity. It is born within us. Wisdom is the capacity to achieve the final salvation called Nirvana. And that wisdom is within ourselves. Therefore, the technique of meditation called Vipassana Bhavana to achieve enlightenment is called wisdom meditation, because it is based not on knowledge but on wisdom. Wisdom we can just define as our capacity to be blissful, escape from suffering, avoid suffering. There is suffering in the world, and when we understand the cause of suffering, we can retain the original bliss of our own mind. The mind is originally blissful because it is free from greed, hatred, and illusion. It is our own greed that brings us suffering. All defilements, all mental defilements are coming into us from the outside. And the real original mind is a pure state of mind. That is why Buddha said our original mind is Pabhasara Vidam Bhikkhave Chittam Agatuke Upakilese Upakrito. Our original mind is pure and blissful and illuminated, radiant. It's a radiant mind, not like a defiled mind. Therefore, for the first 20 years of Buddha's life, the only advice given by the Buddha for self-realization, to realization of oneself, and for the realization of the Four Noble Truths oneself, Buddha said, Sabba papasa akaranam, abstain from defiling the mind. Defilements come from the outside. They are brought by our sense organs, free from such defilement. When the mind is free from defilements, the mind is in a state of wholesomeness. Kusalasya upasampada. Wholesomeness of the mind is not something that we create, that is the original state of our mind. The original state of mind is defined by our sensations. Our sensations says this is good or this is bad. Our sense organs like certain items, dislike certain items through the past experience retained as memories in our own mind. Liking and disliking leads to our suffering. When we like something, we cannot retain it forever. It is subject to birth, decay, and death. Then, when we have something that we dislike, that also brings us suffering. Whatever that we like, when we lose, we suffer. One way, whatever we dislike, when we have, we suffer. It is live without that suffering. The wisdom should come in there. Or that is pleasant, pleasurable. But the wisdom says, don't be attached. Don't have future hopes or dreams. Take it as it is. Enjoy it, but with the mind that it is birth, subject to birth, decay and death. Whenever unpleasant things crops up, be mindful, it too is subject to birth, decay and death. And that is the real nature of the world within ourselves and the world outside us. The world within ourselves and the world outside are not separate from each other. The entire world outside us is reflected in our own mind, in our own body. Therefore, Buddha got enlightened not by observing the world outside, but observing the world reflected within oneself. And that is called self-realization. Buddhist meditation is a technique of observing ourselves, the world within ourselves, and finally get enlightened by not getting disturbed by the worldly vicissitudes. Therefore, we can say the Buddhist meditation is observing ourselves constantly and realization its own true nature, truth, through our own inner wisdom. Not based on tradition, not based on any teaching, we can realize its reality through our own experience. Not dictated by our own experiences, we can see it. Seeing is believing. There are no beliefs in Buddhism. We have to see and realize the truth within ourselves. Therefore, the Buddhist meditation is observing oneself intelligently, diligently, constantly, and wisely.